Hopefully, I like you, you escaped COVID over the holidays and a family member come down with it. It wasn't good, continues to fight it. And you've seen the ads, I'm sure, with Ohio nurses pleading and crying for you to take this virus seriously. Seen that ad like 300 times, right? And here's what's interesting about that. As healthcare workers plead for us to take the virus serious, coronavirus and the new variant, they are also in record numbers not taking the new vaccine. What? Something like 40% of Ohio healthcare workers are refusing to take the vaccination. On that is Paul Seeger. Paul is with PCS Healthcare Advisors, advises large, small, medium businesses on healthcare, and so sees the big picture on this stuff. Paul, good morning. Welcome to 2021. How are you?
Happy New Year, Scott. Doing great.
Yeah, Happy New Year. Thanks for joining. So that's really weird because, as I said, we see these commercials pandering to our own self-interest, and that is wear a mask, take it seriously, get the vaccine. And yet, when you hear that 40%, 4 in 10 Ohio healthcare workers are refusing to take the vaccine, what does that say then? What kind of message does that send to the rest of us? And why are they refusing it?
Yeah, I've even read as high as 60% of nurses in Ohio are declining to take the vaccine, and we hear different messaging as to why that could be happening. In some respects, we're hearing that it's a distribution problem because we were told there'd be 40 million doses out by the end of the year, 20 million, then it got down to 12 and 2.8 million that were actually administered. And although those numbers didn't reach projections, and they are, you know, certainly it's slower than expected, we have, even with that small amount of distribution, there are health systems around the country that are having to have high-level meetings to decide what to do with all the surplus vaccines that they have. So there's a confidence problem, clearly, and I'd say it goes beyond the topic of whether the healthcare folks want to take the vaccine or not, and even gets to all the messaging that we've had through this pandemic that's changed. You know, you lose confidence of people when you say they do need to do something or don't, and you kind of switch your messaging along the way. Mm-hmm. When we're seeing these commercials on the one hand, as you pointed out, and then you have healthcare workers all across the country that are declining in pretty large numbers, that doesn't build the confidence of the average
exactly.
person.
Exactly. In a lot of the doctors I've spoken to, a handful of doctors that I know, all to the man, to the woman, say, I'm taking it, don't mess around. My DO says, just take the vaccine, I'm going to take it. And yet you see these stats, and is it, you know, typically, too, healthcare workers, it's a very broad category, right? Because it's not just doctors and nurses and RNs, but it's also people who are, you know, orderlies, all the way down to orderlies and people who, administrators who work in hospitals, too. So it's to say it's all healthcare workers. Are the numbers drilled down a little bit more? Is it the back of house workers mainly? I mean, it could be people who work in the cafeteria and dietary, right, as opposed to actually nurses and doctors. When you get down to medical practitioners versus the rest of who's considered in that sector, the results start to make a little more sense, or didn't we dig that deep?
Yeah, they do. That's a fair point. When you go into some of the lesser skilled healthcare workers, the declines are higher. So if you go into elderly care facilities, you're going to have a higher percentage that are declining. And they tend to be, that's a lesser qualified position, lesser paid position. Now, that runs into its own challenges. See, you'll have folks that will say, why not mandate the vaccine in that case? And yet you have these facilities that pre-pandemic had a hard enough time hiring staff. That's always been a struggle for that part of the industry. And you have folks that'll let their boss know, well, you've mandated the vaccine, I'm out of here. So how do they manage that? They can't really mandate it effectively. They could legally, but they can't effectively because they'll lose staff and they can't afford to do that.
Yeah, you almost need a bad economy in order for people to take the job. So, I guess, you know, I'll take the vaccine and take my chances because I need to eat. I need to pay my bills, keep a roof over my family's head. So I'll do it now. I'll just go, you know, work another job and maybe make a little couple dollars less or maybe about the same for that matter. So I think that's interesting that it is, as you said, the lower skilled healthcare workers that are refusing the vaccine, despite the fact that all the nurses and doctors are saying, yeah, you really need to protect yourself. But what's scary about it is, in real practice, Paul Seeger, is that we have parents or grandparents that may be in assisted living or nursing homes, whatever. And now you're hearing going, wait, the people who come into contact with them, not the nurses and the doctors and the physicians, but the people who deliver the meals, the people who are cleaning up, all those individuals, 60% and upwards, are refusing the vaccine. They're now putting my loved one's life in danger.
That's a fact. And we've got 88% of the deaths are, you know, a very high percentage are in that part of the population that's 70 plus, and a large percentage, no matter what country you look at, a large percentage are in these care facilities. So it's something we have to deal with, and I think it's clearly a confidence problem. We need to get better messaging out there, more consistent messaging. You hear folks say they don't want to be a guinea pig. They're concerned about allergic reactions. In 2.8 million doses that have been administered in the U.S., there's been 11 allergic reactions. All have been resolved. So that's a very, I mean, it's in very small percentage.
Well, there was a story this weekend, I think, Paul Siegert from PCF Healthcare Advisors, who just joined the show this morning. First of all, welcome. Happy New Year. And we're talking about this interesting phenomenon where you have commercials that are running saying with healthcare providers like nurses from across the state crying on camera and saying, please take the virus seriously, the coronavirus seriously. And yet 40 to 60% of those healthcare workers are refusing to take the vaccine. It's certainly contradictory. That's what we're talking about. And on that, too, you know, we've got a new variant that's coming out there as well. This now we've got the coronavirus has been around long enough for us to see a mutation occur at this point. What do we know about that?
Yeah, we have. It's popped up in the UK. At least they're the first that recognized it. But there's some differences there in how we all track these things country to country. They'll sequence a lot more samples, 2,700 in the month of December, where we sequenced maybe 27. So was it really there first? Who really knows? But it's out there, and it's 50 to 70% is the best modeling as to how much more contagious it is, so how much more quickly it could spread. And then, you know, that, of course, could lead to bigger outbreaks. And we've already got our hospital system is already you know, it's not necessarily overrun. That might be dramatic, but it's not far from being overloaded. Certainly, we need to get it under control. And there are some good examples of places around the world where even without the vaccine heavily distributed, they've been able to control this a lot better than what we're seeing here. There's a town in Germany, Tübingen, Germany, where they've managed to do a very good job of containing this by focusing on these high-risk groups that we're talking about with some very common-sense approaches. They've recognized that almost all deaths were in a certain age group, and a high percentage of those, over half, were in care facilities. So they instituted some pretty common-sense approaches, testing free for everyone in their community. So if you wanted to go visit your elderly grandparent, you could get a test first, 15-minute kind of result test, antigen test. Masks available to the population widely at no cost. And if you're in that age group, you could ride in a taxi, and they would cover the cost of that to keep you away from the rest of the population. And then shopping at the stores from 9 to 11 for that age group. Now, another thing that was really critical to their success, because here there's a huge outbreak going on in Germany, and yet their hospital is so the opposite of being overrun, has so much capacity, they're bringing in patients from other parts of Germany because they're doing so well. They, and I think this is probably the most important part of what they've done, they're doing twice a week testing of all of those workers in those care facilities and the residents. So they're catching those asymptomatic spreaders quickly and giving them 2 weeks of vacation so they can get past it and then they can come back. So it's some pretty common sense things we could institute here that would help with this as we roll this vaccine out.
And Paul, that doesn't seem that far-fetched. I mean, other than the 2 weeks vacation, but you know, we'd probably be reluctant to give. So that actually forces people to work when they're sick or maybe, you know, tamp their symptoms down until they can't work anymore, which is, of course, infects a lot more people. And we know the German model is a lot different, but not too far away in the UK, though. They've got the new variant there. Now, we've seen it here in the United States, I think a handful of states, Florida, California, Colorado, I believe. Yeah. We've seen this new variant of COVID-19 come out that's up to 70% more transmittable, more contagious. And, you know, that obviously drives the vaccine need, too, as well, because we're over the 340,000 fatality mark on this thing. But this mutant virus that we've now found in the States and elsewhere, too, the UK is starting to get overwhelmed here, in a sense. And we're just now into the new year. Healthcare experts here in Ohio and Ada, Kentucky are saying the obvious. Like, look, we're biting our time. We hopefully we don't see it, but we would expect to see the post-holiday surge starting to appear this week, if not next.
Oh, yeah, there was a lot of travel over the holidays, so there most certainly will be a surge. It's pretty, we're going to get to, I was having this conversation with a colleague over the holiday, we will get to herd immunity. The question is, do we get there more through vaccination or more through infection? Mm. One way or another, we're going to get there. And the quicker that we are able to gain the confidence of the public around the vaccine, the better. Yeah. Otherwise, it'll be these surges that get us there, which will lead, of course, to a lot more deaths.
Right. And for those who say, look in the crystal ball here, people go, okay, 2021, this is going to be the year we start to turn the corner, not in quarter one, not probably in quarter two, but by quarter three. And certainly in this time next year, things are going to look a lot different. Would you agree with that?
I would, although I have to say, I feel like looking back at some of the projections I was making 3 months ago, they seemed pretty far-fetched currently. We've got 21 million frontline healthcare workers, of course, a third or so are declining to take the vaccine. But we got, regardless of that, we've got 21 million of those, 3 million in care homes, and we've administered 2.8 million or so doses by the end of the year. So there's a lot left in that first group. Now, we do expect production will ramp up and the kinks in the supply chain will get worked out. I think it would have been unrealistic to expect that there wouldn't have been any kinks. Mm-hmm. But, you know, we're working through that as expected, I would say. But this next group is 49 million in the next phase. That's elderly that are not in care facilities and frontline workers. That's between the two, we're, you know, well into the 70 plus million. So there's a lot of work to go there, and I think we certainly do have to be ready to hunker down for a few quarters at least.
When do we see the light? We like take me to, let's say, here's a milestone for you, Paul Seeger, quickly. Thanksgiving 2021, Christmas 2021. What do you say?
I think we'll be a lot further along. I really do. And I think by then we will have had those of us in the normal category, quote unquote, in that not in a high risk group, but the rest of the population will have gotten access to the vaccine. They will ramp up production. So I expect by late summer we should be getting access to the vaccine and be able to see a much more normal holiday season. And then I think we also could stand to institute some of these fairly common sense approaches that are working in other places, and those could help too with bringing back a more normal way of living.
Well, hopefully, and I know new normal is a tired thing to say, but it really is. Paul Seeger with PCS Healthcare Advisors, thanks for joining the show. Appreciate it. And
happy
New Year.
Happy New Year.
I'm sure.